Here we go, you guys. We do this every week. We gather as Jesus' people. We come from all over the place, man. Every type of story represented in the room. I know it. And we come to focus, to center ourselves on the person of Jesus, to remind ourselves of good news. So we're going to listen to Jesus tell a really good story today and give us all a kind punch in the gut. Sound good? All right then, I invite you to open your Bibles and turn to the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 25. Open or turn it on, whatever it is you do with your Bible. And Matthew chapter 25. If you have one of those Bibles that puts all of the words of Jesus in red, it's very common. And as you turn to Matthew 25, you're going to see, we're just lost in a sea of red words right now. This is one of the largest collections of Jesus' teachings all in one place in the Gospel according to Matthew. And it was all launched by something we explored a couple weeks back. Jesus threw a grenade in the room, so to speak. He said this shocking, jaw-dropping thing to his closest circle of followers. If he would have said it in public, to a bigger setting, he surely would have gotten crucified much earlier. And he predicted, they were in Jerusalem and they're looking at the temple, and Jesus made a prediction about the temple, namely, it's going down. This building's going to be destroyed and taken down to pieces. And that's a dangerous thing. You know, if you, in our country, you know, start tweeting out that you're making plans to blow up the White House or something, you know, the FBI's at your house immediately, you know, they know all about you already because they track all of us all the time. Anyway, so, right, so this is a very inflammatory, dangerous thing for Jesus to say. He said it within his closest circle of followers, and they have questions immediately. This was in chapter 24. And their first question, do you remember their first question to him? When? When's this going to happen, right? It's the most horrifying thing I can imagine. When's that going to happen? And conveniently, we still have the drawing I have up from a couple of weeks ago. They say, when is Jerusalem going to fall? And Jesus said, do you remember? Within 40 years. And then that prompted another question from them, and because in their minds, this is connected to the big story of Jesus as the prophet and the Messiah. And if Jerusalem's leaders reject him, right, justice comes on Jerusalem, then where is Jesus' kingdom? Like, when's that coming? When is Jesus going to come and become king over all the nations? And they asked that question too. And then Jesus' answer to that was not 40 years, but yeah, I have no clue when that's going to go down. He just says, I don't know. The angels don't know. I don't know. Only the Father knows. And then that launched him into a whole sea of teachings and now parables and short stories where he's exploring what it means to be one of his disciples in this in-between time where he's been executed and raised from the dead. The fall of the city demonstrates his truth as a prophet. His resurrection is his exaltation as king of the world. So, you know, to be a follower of Jesus is to have hope that his kingdom will come and his will be done here on earth as it is in heaven fully one day. And so we live with that reality begun and kickstarted with what happened with Jesus, but not fully brought to its completion. And so how does Jesus want us to live in this in-between season? And it's a long one, 2,000 years and counting, right? It's a long season. And so his basic watchword is to be ready, to be prepared, right? That we cultivate this mindset of expectation that at any point Jesus' kingdom could come fully here and surprise us all. And so he started telling parables, you know, about people who weren't ready. You know, he told that story about the 10 young women who were invited to the wedding, but then the wedding came and they weren't ready, and too bad for 5 of them. And about this guy who was given all this responsibility by his boss, and then his boss went on a journey and came back, and he's, you know, partying it up and squandering it all, and this bad news for him. And so now Jesus is going to explore another facet of this today. It's in chapter 25, and he's not just going to warn us to be ready, but he wants to begin to explore to us what it actually looks like to live in a constant state of readiness. You know, does it mean you have like bags packed by the front door all of the time? You know, like what does that mean? In many Christian traditions, especially those kind of given to a lot of hype and speculation about the end of the world, it can lead to a sense of expectation that makes people care less about the day-to-day life and their world and it's all going to burn and that kind of thing. And I think Jesus is very clear that's not what he means. In his mind, to be ready and to be prepared for his kingdom to come means that every moment, every day is charged with significance, and every person you meet and every relationship, every conversation, it's all meaningful. It gives everything meaning because they're going to redeem this world, which means everything becomes meaningful. And so what does that look like practically? Well, he tells a short story that we're going to read today. This is a short story about the kingdom of heaven and what it's like. Verse 14 is where we're picking up in Matthew chapter 25. So again, the kingdom of heaven will be like a man going on a journey. And so he called his servants and he entrusted his wealth to them. To one, he gave 5 bags of gold. Now, I'm reading from the New International Version, which has bags of gold, but I know there's other translations in the room. Talents. Yes, talents. Now, so this is kind of funny. So you're reading an English translation. That's wonderful. We're so grateful, right, that you don't all have to learn Greek and Hebrew or whatever. But then sometimes our translations just say, like, no, I'm not going to translate that ancient word. And you're looking at one, talent. But it's confusing to us because talent is also an English word, isn't it? It means your special ability, right? So can you juggle? You know, can you play the piano or ride the unicycle? That's your talent or whatever. And so it's led to this kind of reading of the story where it's about Jesus passing out special abilities and you better juggle for Jesus or else you'll go to hell or something like that, you know? Okay, right. So first of all, the word talent, it's a unit of money that's an ancient Greek word. So it's not the English word at all. I hope you have a footnote or something to say this is an enormous amount of money. And Bible nerds debate, is it 1 year's worth of somebody's income? Is it 5 years or 20 years? The point is, it's an enormous amount of money. Years and years, decades of someone's lifetime to earn this much money. That's the point. And the first guy, he gets how many bags of gold? That's an enormous amount of money. Just think zillions or something like that. I don't know. 5 bags, we'll go with bags of gold. To another, he gave 2 bags of gold, and to another, he gave 1 bag of gold, each according to his ability. Then the master went on his journey. Now the man who received 5 bags of gold, he went at once, and he put his money to work, and he gained 5 bags more. It's amazing. So also, the one with 2 bags of gold, he gained 2 more. Also remarkable. But the man who received 1 bag, he went off and he dug a hole in the ground and he hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants returned and he settled accounts with them. And so the man who received 5 bags of gold, he brought the other 5 and he said, "Master, look at this, holy cow. You entrusted me with 5 bags of gold and look, 5 more. Unbelievable." And his master replied, "Yes, well done. Good, faithful servant. Man, you've been faithful with a few things." A few is 5 gazillion bags of gold, right? So a few. "And I'll put you in charge of way more. Come on, share in your master's happiness." Again, New International Version, but some of you don't have happiness, you have joy. Yeah, share in your master's joy. I think it's more rich. Idea. Then the man with 2 bags of gold, he also came. "Master," he said, "come on, you gave me 2 bags of gold. Look, 2 more." His master replied, "Yes, gold star, right? A plus. good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I'll put you in charge of many, many things. Come, come, share in your master's happiness or joy. Okay, good story so far? Yes, everybody's a winner, you know? Everybody's on the A team. Verse 24. Then the man who received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, listen, I know that you're a really hard man. Now that's news. Right, just stop right there. We'll unpack this more. Is there anything in the parable that gives you an indication that this is a hard, merciless Scrooge of a man? Just the opposite, actually. He seems incredibly happy and generous and a great person to work for. That's just my opinion, but there we go. But for this guy, his first words out of his mouth are, listen, I know you're kind of a jerk. And here's how I know this, because you harvest where you haven't sown and you gather where you haven't scattered seed. Listen, I was afraid, and so I went out and I hid your gold in the ground, but here it is back. What belongs to you? And so his master replied, you're a wicked, lazy servant. You knew that I harvest where I haven't sown and gather where I haven't scattered seed. So you should have just put my money on deposit in the bank, at least so that when I returned, I could have gotten it back with some interest. Then he starts talking to somebody else. We don't know, guards or something like that. So take the bag of gold from him, give it to the guy who has 10. For whoever has will be given more, and they'll have an abundance. Whoever doesn't have, even what they do have, will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Oh, man. Jesus, this story was going great, and then wicked, lazy hardness or whatever, and now darkness forever. Rah. Anybody? This is kind of a roller coaster, yeah? Jesus, he was a master storyteller, and he knows how to bring us in. He knows how to work our expectations and then surprise. So it's a powerful story. My hunch is that maybe a number of you, if you've been followers of Jesus for a long time or whatever, you've heard the story of Jesus before. There might be some of us here who we're like, yeah, that third guy, he's the jerk, so he deserves what he gets. My hunch is that there's also an undercurrent in the room, but you feel like it's not okay to voice your doubts in church or something like that. But you have real, reservations about this master fellow. Because, you're thinking, sheesh, you're a successful businessman. There's this guy, he's timid. Maybe he didn't have an affirming father or something. And, he's scared of taking risks. And, and now he's going to get punished forever for it. It's so intense, Maybe this guy is kind of a jerk. Now, you don't have to raise your hand if that thought occurred to you, but I know it occurred to some of you at least. So what's going on here? Well, part of this is that Jesus, he was a master at these short fictional tales that grabbed your attention, got you thinking about who God is and who he is and who you are. So he knows what he's doing, right? He's trying to mess with you. But in what way is he trying to mess with you? And I think part of our challenge with lots of the parables of Jesus is that for us, the short fictional story, that we come across, the short tales that we know in whatever TV and in literature, right? Those are stories that fit with our values. And then, so our values are like tolerance and everybody's got their hang-ups, but everybody can become a winner, that kind of thing. And this story just doesn't really work like that, does it? It's different. That's because Jesus is not an American, right? And he's not things don't always work out. And he's telling a story in a first century Jewish, Roman cultural setting. It's an honor-shame culture. It's very, very different, very different. And so before we bulldoze over this and accuse Jesus for not telling the story we would have liked him to tell, we should actually pay attention to the story he is telling. And it's full of surprises. This happens all the time to me where, you know, it's a story that I thought I had reflected on enough, and then I all of a sudden have to talk about it in front of my church, and then I realize, like, oh my gosh, there's all these things I've never noticed before, and that this is such a beautiful and profound story. So here's what I want to do. I want to, you know, kind of walk through the parable, pointing out things that Jesus is highlighting and how they transform this into a story that I didn't even see coming a month ago, you know, when I knew that I was going to be up here teaching it. But first, this is true for all of the parables. Anytime Jesus tells a parable, which is often, he tells a lot of them. The first thing you should always be doing is like, who's talking to me? Jesus. This pop quiz. Who's telling a parable? You can all get this one right. No failure. Everybody's a winner in this one, right? Pop quiz. Who's telling a parable? Jesus of Nazareth. So, okay, Jesus. Is Jesus just an unreflective person who just believes, you know, in the status quo and always thinks the masters and those in power are the good guys and the servants are the bad guys, right? Is this Jesus that we know? No, of course not. Like, we know Jesus, did Jesus pull any punches when he saw bad leaders abusing their responsibilities? Did he have any qualms about saying something about it? No. This is the same Jesus who had a heartbeat for people who got ground up by the powers that be, you know? This is a gracious, compassionate Jesus, right? A person that I would love to even try and be like, how gracious and compassionate he was. And so, but what was his mission? Because these stories are all about what he's doing there in Jerusalem. His mission was to announce the kingdom of God and to bring God's reign and rule into the world, first to the people of Israel, God's covenant people. And think through the story that Jesus grew up in the Hebrew Scriptures and that he believes about who God is and who Israel is. Israel, in the story of the Hebrew Scriptures, is the ultimate resourced, gifted servant, right? That the God of Israel, just out of his justice and generosity, he rescues the slaves out of Egypt, and he provides for them through the wilderness, even when they're complaining and so on. He gives them all of the laws of the Torah, his justice and wisdom. He brings them into the promised land. And what was the whole point of that story? The whole point was that this covenant people of God be so shaped by their closeness to God that they become these priests to the nations. Or in God's words to Abraham, they become a blessing to the nations. New and different kinds of humans that become a blessing to all of these other humans. And that's not what happened, right? And Jesus looks at the leaders of Jerusalem of his day and the Israel of his day, and he's like, yeah, that's not what's happening, like, at all. Israel, in Jesus' mind, has been given the ultimate set of gifts, a zillion bags of gold. And instead of becoming a blessing to the nations, what are they going to do? They're setting up to begin a rebellion against Rome. I mean, the temple, instead of being the source of God's presence and blessing, it becomes the hotbed of like tribal nationalism, and the treasury is going to fund a military rebellion against Rome. They're going to wage war on the nations instead of blessing them. And so think of what Jesus was doing. He's forming a new covenant people, a people who bless their enemies instead of killing them, a people who work the hardest at spreading peace, a people who love their neighbor as themselves, people who will actually become the blessing to the nations that he called them to be. And so for Jesus, like, he's in the business of forming this new people who will come under his reign as the king and who will actually do what God made his people to do, which is to be glorious humans who reflect his image and become a blessing to others. And so Jesus, like, this is what he's not just going to live and die and be raised for people so they can sit back and be like, yeah, this is great, you know, I got my ticket to the good place after I die. Like, that's just so not the story at all of what the Bible's trying to tell us. The whole point is that humans become who God made them to be, to become a blessing to others. And so it's in that setting that Jesus tells a story about what it's like to be a part of his kingdom and one of his disciples. And he says it's like a master who's going to go away on a journey, right? We've got this gap. Something's going to go down in 40 years, and then I don't know when the kingdom's going to come. Be ready in the meantime. And in that meantime, it's like a master who's just giving out resources to his servants. And we got three examples here. 5 bags of gold. Sheesh, Louise. Talk about generosity, right? But not everybody gets 5. Did you see that? It's actually a really, really important detail that Jesus builds in and develops in the story here. The first guy gets 5. What's the second guy get? And what's the third guy get? And what's the principle of distribution? Each according to his ability. And this is really key. It's going to come up again, this theme, this idea. Each according to his ability. So this says something about the servant, and this says something about the master that Jesus wants to portray. So the servants, like, they're not the same people, right? That should be obvious to us, but this is in the economy of Jesus' kingdom, there's no, like, one size fits all. You all go and be like this. So there's lots of people in the kingdom with lots of different stories, lots of different backgrounds, and lots of different capabilities. And so each servant is expected to be productive to the degree that they're capable. It's very, very profound, actually, right? There's no comparing. There's just, you're you. You have your story, your abilities. Pretty sure you are fully capable of being this kind of human. Let's go with that. And what does it say about the master? I think this is the most profound. So what this says about the master is that he really knows these guys. Yeah? Like he has this like intimate knowledge. He knows that the person with 5 is fully, fully capable of that. It's not too great a demand. It's not too little of a demand. But the person with 2, no way they could handle 5. 5 would ruin them. Right? It's this really intimate awareness. Right? And the master accommodates and just gives everybody exactly what he knows that they're capable of. So they each go out, and so that, you know, we're built up. It's all about patterns. This story is about there's the pattern of 1, 2, and then 3 you expect, and then the third one breaks it. So the first guy goes out and 100% return. Whoa. Second guy goes out. He earns 2 more bags. Does the second guy earn the same as the first guy? No. Is that going to matter to the master? No, of course not, because that's not really what this is about, is it? The bottom line, it's not about that. But then the third guy, it's clearly a contrast. He's got something going on inside of him because he doesn't do anything. He digs a hole. It's like a scavenger hunt, you know? I don't know. Like, are we told why he does this yet? No, he hides it. He hides it. This is interesting. The word hide is used very seldom, actually, in Jesus' teachings. One of the only other times that it's used is earlier in the Sermon on the Mount, where he says, you know, the city on the hill, you all are my followers, the city on a hill. And you're like a light that shines out to everybody, but what you should never do is hide it under a basket. And then once again, we have this image here of somebody given this amazing resource and responsibility, and what do they do with it? They hide it. They hide it. So what are the talents? If it's not juggling for Jesus, you know, like what is it? Well, it's a parable. So you're supposed to participate in the meaning of this thing. So it's obviously money. Money, it's a resource. It opens up opportunities for you to do things that you couldn't do otherwise. But think about what you do with your money. There's things that you like need, there's cost of living, there's like needs. Then if there's any left over, you have a choice, right? Do you save it? Do you invest it? Do you give it away? Like money has this way of getting to our hearts. I think Jesus said something about that once. And it shows where our loyalties and where our true values are. And so when we have extra money, do we think about others' well-being, or do we think about our own well-being? And for this guy, it's not sure what he's thinking about. He's not making the most of anything. He hides it in the ground. How much time passes? Verse 19, a long time. Now that's interesting. Why does Jesus build that into the story? So we're left to wonder, did these guys earn 100% return, you know, in a week? In a month? Just a long time. And then this is very interesting. So it's not just about he had a bad week or something. He had a back injury and he couldn't work. I'll dig it in the ground. You know, this is a long time. So the point is that the passage of time, who we are, our true character, and our true values are something that get developed along this trajectory of our lives. And so it's not just like one bad patch. Over a long period of time, these guys are faithful and productive. And then over a long period of time, this guy sits on it and does nothing. Whatever's motivating him, he doesn't value what his master values. And so he puts it in the ground. A long time passes, and then the master comes. And then it's happy days, right? I mean, it's just such a great story after that. For some reason, I remember reading this parable when I was a new Christian, and I always had, somehow this story happened on a stage in my visual imagination, like an award ceremony. It's probably not true, but that's what happens in my head. And it could be. I was such a loser in high school. I never won any awards. I didn't win anything. So it could be a subtle Freudian thing going on there. Anyway, who knows? It's just happening, you know, over drinks or something. I don't know. So he's settling accounts. No, they're in the you know, the business, the office or something. So he shows him, hey, look, five. And the master's stoked. He's stoked on five. And we'll talk about his response in a second. But then the guy with two comes in, and look, it's identical. Do you see that? It's the absolute identical response. Yes, well done. Now stop and think about that. What he doesn't say, and with the guy with two comes in, he's like, hey, two more. He doesn't say like, oh, that's well done, but did you see the guy with five? You know, like there's just no comparison. It's the each according to his own ability. So like he knows that for the person with two, this is everything. They put in everything they had. And he knows that's what they were capable of, and it makes him so stoked. It doesn't matter that someone just came in and made over two times more. That doesn't matter. It's totally immaterial. Do you see that right here? And once again, Jesus is developing the portrait of this master here. He's generous. First of all, he's generous. And then second of all, we're beginning to get a hunch, like this really isn't just about the bottom line for this guy. Because he's just stoked that people do what they're capable of. And look at what he says to both of these two guys. So he says, you know, good and faithful servant, you've been faithful with a little bit, as if five bags of gold is a little bit, right? And so what he wants to do is he says, yes, more for you, you know? Look at all these other things I want to give to you too. And then the last line is so powerful. Come share in your master's joy. So what's the these are very fine brushstrokes Jesus is painting with here. What's the portrait of this master? He's generous. He knows people very closely. He doesn't have unreasonable, harsh demands. This apparently was never about just making lots of profit. His joy comes from people becoming what he knows they're capable of being. Do you see that? What makes this guy stoked? Just that he's making money? We're actually going to see, if with the line a little bit later, he's actually going to let them keep all of the profit anyway. He just says it down here. We didn't know that was taking place, but then all of a sudden the guy who made five and five, he gets to keep it all, he says down here. So this isn't even about making money for the master. This is about developing people. And what he invites them into at the very end is to come on. Like this is so delightful. this is such an occasion for joy that you took what you had and you became an even more glorious, productive human than you even thought you were capable of becoming. Do you see the picture here? I'm just trying to paint the picture. Because we read right over this. Jesus so camps out on this, he tells us the thing identically twice. It's a beautiful picture. I want to work for this person, right? I'm not saying the elders at Door of Hope aren't these people, but I'm just saying, you know, like, it sounds like a great work environment. You know what I'm saying? Super, everybody's a winner. He sets us up with a pattern, and then the third guy. What are the first words out of the third guy's mouth? The man who got one bag of gold came, and he said, "Master, yeah, listen, I know you're kind of a jerk. I know you're a hard man." It's a metaphor, of course, but it's the word for like a rock, hard, right? Unmoving, stubborn, merciless, hard. "Listen, I know you're a really hard-nosed, kind of unmoving jerk of a person, right? And as you, the listener to the story, what's going on inside of you?" You're like, "Wait, no, actually, I'm pretty sure he's like the most generous, delightful person I've ever seen. Where did he get this?" Right? He has this story in his head about the master. Where did he get it from? Well, he says, "Listen, I know you're a hard man because I see you. I see your work ethic." And what happens? He says, "I see that you harvest where you haven't sown, and you gather where you haven't scattered seed." It's like a figure of speech. So he's so productive and successful that he puts his hand to a task, or he makes an investment, or he puts all this energy into a business or something, and it's productive. But he's actually so productive and successful, even the things that he puts in little or no effort are productive and successful. Do you see? That's what he's saying here. And so he says, "Listen, I can see that you're a very successful person. And that's how I know that you're a hard man." He observes his behavior, makes this character assumption about the master, and says, "So listen, you know, I was afraid. And so I hid your gold in the ground. Here's back what belongs to you." Now, this is great. This is like, right up until this point in the story, this is like an episode of Growing Pains. Are you right? Remember Growing Pains? Kirk Cameron. What was his name? Mike Sievers. Anybody? And the shirts that he would wear. I was looking to him, man, when I was a kid. He's forward, fashion forward. Anyway, so right. Thanks. So this is like episode of Full House or Family Ties or whatever, right? So this is like, you know, the son and Mike Sievers, and there's a science exam coming up, and his dad loved science and he did really great. "Son, oh, you know, you're great. I love science. You're gonna do great." And you know, Mike Sievers has all this anxiety coming up, all the pressure. "I can't take it." And he gets a C. You know, and he comes home and he's like, "Dad, I can't take the pressure." You guys know what I'm talking? Wouldn't this be a good episode? I should have written for the, right? That's how we think of what's happening here, right? It's the timid, insecure guy. There's too much pressure. He feels like he has to be a perfectionist because, you know, this guy's really successful. And so what we want to happen is that the master says like, "Oh, buddy, you know, no, there's no pressure. Come on, let's try this again." You know, that's how we want this to end. But it doesn't end that way. And it's not because Jesus is a bad storyteller. It's because he's not a writer for American sitcoms, right? So in Jesus' parables, people are their behavior. They're very simple cardboard characters for the most part. And people are their archetypes and caricatures. And so what this guy represents, think in Jesus' day, in an honor-shame culture, he's just been given this huge, generous gift. And by a really generous, delightful employer. And somehow he's bought into this extremely distorted narrative about who this man is. So much so that he says he's afraid, but we're actually going to see he's not afraid. He actually attributes evil or something to his master Because if he actually was just afraid of taking risks, and this was a perfectionism performance issue, what could he have done that there was no risk but still made something? He could have put it in the bank. So his actions even betray his words, right? And the master exposes that. He says, you're wicked. You assume the worst and you treat people accordingly. And you actually value yourself more than you value anybody else. Because, listen, what makes you think that I'm a hard jerk of a person? Because I'm successful and productive. Listen, if that was the real reason why, that you were just scared about being productive, you could have put it in the bank, if this is a fear issue. And so the master discerns, like, no, this is a deeper issue. Like, there is evil in your heart. And you assume evil of others. You assume the worst. And in an honor-shame society, like, this man is publicly saying, what I think of you is what I did with your money, which is nothing. It's a statement. And his actions speak louder than his words. That's how things work in Jesus' parables. And so here's how this cashes out. He says, take the one bag from him and give it to the guy with 10. And then we learn, oh my gosh, you get to keep your profits. This is a great job. Right? This is not about money. This is for this guy, right? This is about developing people. And then he has this thing, whoever has will be given more and they'll have an abundance. Whoever doesn't have, even what they do have will be taken from them. What's going on here? So this is called an aphorism or a little proverb. It's using economics as a metaphor of spiritual perception. So there's something about how people perceive Jesus when people, for whatever reason, we don't know, but maybe you've been here before, or maybe people that you care about or know have this thing, but they hate Jesus, or they hate God, and they have a story in their head about who Jesus is, that he's a jerk, that, he's a perfectionist, and whatever, he wants everybody to behave the same way, or else he's going to kill them forever and ever, something like that. And maybe, this person who has this story in their head, they've actually met some really self-righteous jerk of a Christians before, or had them in their family, and so they've been burned, and they have reason to think that. But Jesus is saying, once you believe in your mind, you have this perception about who the master is, and it's totally skewed, you have nothing. And all of a sudden, anything Jesus says or does, or anything a Christian says or does, will only feed that narrative, and even what they do have is taken from them. I think that's what he's talking about. How many of you have been in a situation before? This might happen quite often in marriage relationships in the room, but not only there, in other ways, where you're in a conflict or you're in a situation and you realize, like, oh my gosh, this person really believes the worst about me. And they have this story in their head about why I said or did that, and it's totally the wrong motive and it's totally not true. But I can't do anything to change what they think about me. Anybody? Have you been in this scenario before? It's very frustrating. And then what you realize is, like, oh my gosh, everything I say or do is just digging the hole worse because I'm just feeding into their story. There's something like that Jesus is getting at here. This guy's so lost in his distorted version of the master that he can't get out of it. But the moment somebody's open to who Jesus is, like the moment somebody sees the true generosity and the delight that Jesus has in people and in people becoming who God made them to be, all of a sudden, once that becomes compelling to you, it's like the little that you have, it's just he becomes more and more and more compelling. And here we all are sitting here every single week. We can't wait to come here and hear stories about Jesus because he's so amazing. And so to those who have more and more given, and it's just this abundance. And so it's this inverse proportion, right, of spiritual perception. And so some, because of their openness, they end up sharing in the master's joy. But this guy, he can't get out of his head. And he ends up in darkness. Well, darkness. This isn't the only time Jesus used this metaphor. It's a metaphor because he's telling a parable. Jesus used lots of images to describe a human's existence who chooses to distance themselves from Jesus, the author of life, the generous author of life. And so he used lots of images. Fire's the most well-known image, but darkness is one too. So what's happening here? It's an image of loss. It's an image of isolation. And there's a Christian theologian and thinker who more than any other has helped me grasp what I think Jesus is getting at with these images. C.S. Lewis, anybody? Chronicles of Narnia, any fans? Not the movies. Never see the movies. But the books are pure gold. What's the name of the last book? Also, pop quiz. The Last Battle, there you go. I guess you failed. Right, only two people knew. The Last Battle. And this is at the end of The Last Battle. It's an amazing story, but essentially Aslan, the lion figure, who's this Jesus God figure, he's defeated evil all throughout the land of Narnia. And what he's doing is he's inviting all these creatures of Narnia. No matter what decisions they made in the past, they now, because of his defeat of evil, he's inviting them to come be a part of his new world. And the way to get into the new world, right, is you having this conversation, and there's a door into the new, wonderful, redeemed Narnia beyond. And it's the door, it looks like you're going into a stable, it says. And so all these people are going in, and they're discovering the wonders of this new country, and they're running into it, and so on. But then there's a group of dwarves. Interesting, dwarves. And the dwarves aren't bad guys, but they're not good guys. They just hate everybody in the story. Some overlap with Tolkien's depiction of the dwarves too. And so they hate Aslan, and so they are afraid that Aslan's going to kill them, and so they run into the stable door, and they're convinced that it's all a trick, that there is no new world, and that what they're being chased into by this lion is a dark barn. Well, where, you know, something terrible is going to happen to them. And how they experience the new world is this, described in this scene. So Aslan raised his head, and he shook his mane. And instantly a glorious feast appeared on the dwarf's knees. Pies and pigeons. I don't know if that sounds good to you. But it's a British thing, I think, right? Pies and pigeons and trifles and ices. And each dwarf had a goblet of good wine in his right hand. But it wasn't much use. They began eating and drinking greedily enough, but it was clear that they couldn't taste it properly. They thought they were eating and drinking only the sort of things you might find in a stable. One said he was trying to eat hay. Another said he got a bit of an old turnip. And a third said that he'd found a raw cabbage leaf. And they raised their golden goblets of rich red wine to their lips, and they said, "Ugh, fancy drinking water out of a trough that the donkey's been at. Never thought we'd come to this." But very soon every dwarf began suspecting that every other dwarf had found something nicer than he had. And so they started grabbing and snatching, and they went on to quarreling, till in a few minutes there was a free fight, and all of the good food was smeared on their faces, and their clothes were trodden underfoot. And when at last they sat down to nurse their black eyes and bleeding noses, they all said, "Well, at any rate, there's no humbug here. We haven't let anyone take us in. The dwarves are for the dwarves." "You see," Aslan said to the children, the Pevensey children, "they will not let us help them. They have chosen cunning instead of belief. Their prison is only in their minds, yet they are in that prison, and so afraid of being taken in that they cannot be taken out." Do you get it? It's very powerful. It's very, so profound. So what's the story, what's Jesus trying to do with the story? And this is the surprise for me. It's this contrasting portraits between people who grasp who the master is, truly, and how do they know who the master truly is? By his behavior, right? His generosity, and how he celebrates what people can become and so on. But then there's this other portrait of the master, and it's this guy's trapped in his head, and therefore it's his reality, that this guy is a jerk. He's out to get me. This is about the surprise pop quiz at the end, and I didn't do the right thing, and now here I am punished forever. And of course, that's not reality, but that's his reality. And so Jesus uses this image of darkness, right, to be trapped of my own choice with a portrait of who Jesus is that's not reality. But Jesus, like, this is so true to Jesus' character, isn't it? Right? Where he gives people the dignity of choosing to respond to him. And very seldom does Jesus, like, bonk people over the head. He did it to the Apostle Paul, right? He just shocked him on the road to Emmaus. But that's not Jesus' normal way of working. It's like Jesus actually wants to activate the fully responsible decision-making humans inside of us. Because when activated by his grace, humans just become so fully themselves and alive. And this actually has nothing to do with their performance, because it doesn't matter if you produce 5, it doesn't matter if you produce 2. What matters is like grasping who the master is, and that he invites us to share in his joy and generosity, and that they become who he made them to be. So man, I don't know, I have no idea what your week was like before coming into here. This isn't just about using your special talent to, you know, serve Jesus. This is about each of us has a life, like you're a human. And you're a unique human, and you and I all have these unique resources and opportunities, and we all have people in our lives. And we can take who we are and feed the narrative that life is hard for me because God's a jerk and he's out to get me and this is all, right? And you can just see, you know where that goes. That just leads you to isolation and to darkness. But then I can be open to this surprising reality of who Jesus is, and that despite the difficulties, like, he's actually making me more human. He doesn't give me anything I'm not capable of, and he actually wants me to follow him. And to, like, love my neighbor as myself, and to be generous, and to pay attention to the people in our city that he paid attention to and cared for. Like, he actually thinks that we're capable of doing that because he's committed to us, because of his generosity. And so at the end of the day, this is about the power source for becoming who Jesus calls us to be is himself. It's who we believe him to be. Do we believe he's trapping us, right, in darkness, or do we actually believe who he is, that he's for us, and that he lived for us, and that he died for us, that he was raised for us, and that his presence is with you, and that he really wants you to make the right choice and to follow him? And so let's go right there as we close, and as we come into a time of worship and prayer. As we come to take the bread and the cup, I just encourage you to get the coworker, to get the family member or the relationship, the opportunity this last week that you bailed on to love your neighbor as yourself, and to ask Jesus, what are you supposed to do about that? What has he given you that you didn't produce with this last week? And what does it mean to own up to our failures? To come to him again, realize that he's for us, and to ask him to help us follow him in the week to come. Let me close us in a word of prayer.